astronomers have observed what they call a young rogue planet that appears to be growing at an impossibly rapid rate. Rather than the slow accretion process in standard gravitational theory, they've witnessed the object forming at a rate of up to billions of metric tons per second. Both the object's astonishingly rapid growth and other physical features blur the theoretical line between a planet and a star in conventional theory. The object has been observed in a star-forming complex 620 light-years away. As described in a recent Science Alert report, not only is this the highest growth rate ever recorded for a planetary mass object, it is exhibiting behavior only ever seen before in growing stars and brown dwarfs. Yet it's just 5 to 10 times the mass of Jupiter, well below the 80 Jupiter lower mass limit for stars, and the 13 Jupiter lower mass limit for brown dwarfs. Astronomers measured a peak accretion rate of about 6 billion metric tons per second, and the burst persisted for at least 2 months. A lead investigator said of the findings, "This is the strongest accretion episode ever recorded for a planetary mass object." Now, the following statements in the Science Alert report are of self-evident significance for the Electric Universe community. Everything looked pretty standard until late June, when the object abruptly brightened. The increase in light, the astronomers were astonished to discover, resembled nothing so much as an X-or burst, a brightness increase seen in a young star, typically associated with an episode of accelerated accretion. Crucially, its spectrum showed hydrogen features that are the hallmark of magnetically funneled accretion seen in stellar X-or bursts. A careful analysis ensued, along with an examination of archival data. The researchers found that not only had the object's accretion increased to 6 to 8 times its typical rate, but it also done so at least once before, back in 2016, suggesting that these outbursts may be recurring. It was still ongoing when observations ended in August. Now, for members of the Electric Universe and plasma cosmology communities, terminology like, quote, magnetically tunneled accretion leaves one wondering if astronomers have literally never heard of the well-documented electrical discharge phenomenon called the Z-pinch, or Bennett pinch. Hannes Alfvén proposed that the Z-pinch is the process by which stars form, along lines of electric currents flowing through the interstellar medium. I don't need to remind longtime viewers that the images of star-forming filaments reveal characteristics that can never be explained gravitationally. The filaments are of a constant or near-constant width, across distances up to light-years. In an electric universe, both star and planet formation happen exponentially more rapidly than in gravity-centric cosmology. And for several years now, the discoveries affirming this outrageous prediction have grown with increasing rapidity. As we reported several months ago, astronomers have observed what appear to be fully formed planets about the disk of a so-called protostar, which is a star that is no more than several thousand years old. While the glacially slow process of planet formation by gravitational accretion might take a million years, the observed growth rate of 6 billion metric tons per second is self-evidently a stunning affirmation of Electric Universe theory. Now, Wall Thornhill, the chief proponent of the Electric Universe theory, argued that gas giant planets also form by the electromagnetic Z-pinch. In fact, we need to take a moment now and reconsider some of the fundamental concepts thought to delineate planets and stars. I'd like to take you back now to 2018, when I interviewed Wall on a strikingly similar discovery of a so-called rogue planet, which also left astronomers totally flummoxed. This planet was not accompanied by a parent star, and it likewise blurred the line between a gas giant and a brown dwarf star. It was said to be about a dozen times more massive than Jupiter, and yet its magnetic field was about 200 times stronger than Jupiter's. Investigator Greg Hallinan said of the object's stupendous magnetism that it, quote, presents huge challenges to our understanding of the dynamo mechanism that produces the magnetic fields in brown dwarfs and exoplanets, and helps drive the auroras we see. Of course, this statement assumes that astronomers' beliefs about the cause of auroras and magnetic fields are actually correct. It happens that the Juno and Cassini missions to the respective gas giants, Jupiter and Saturn, completely undermined astronomers' beliefs about both. Jupiter's magnetic field was found to be twice as powerful as astronomers had previously estimated, And the atmospheric phenomena we observe, including fixed polygonal cyclones at the respective north and south poles of both gas giants, are remarkable affirmations of the incoming Birkeland currents, which induce the magnetic fields and the X-ray auroras on both planets. As Wall explained in our 2018 interview, in electromagnetically accreted nebular clouds, gas giant planets form along the same Birkeland current filaments as do stars. As the mass of the bodies along a filament increase, the snaking motion of the filament leaves them behind. It is then that, quote, electrogravitic capture takes place, which forms the amazingly varied exoplanetary systems that continue to puzzle astronomers. However, some of the newborn bodies will not be captured, and yet they are not rogue or orphaned, having not escaped from a parent star. Such bodies are hard to detect, Wall explained, because the electrical energy they intercept from the galaxy is much lower than bright photospheric stars. And in an electric universe, there is no lower limit to the size of a body that can accept electrical energy from the galaxy. In standard astronomy, brown dwarf stars are considered too massive to be planets, and yet not massive enough to sustain the nuclear fusion of hydrogen in their cores. However, again, in the electric universe, the power source is not any internal action, but an external Birkeland current. Let's take a listen to Wall in his own words, as he dissects the theoretical constraints thought to delineate planets and stars.
The light of a red star is due to the distended anode glow of an electrically low-stressed star. Our sun's more compact red anode glow is seen briefly as the chromosphere during total solar eclipses. Beyond the heliosphere and the sun's electrical domain, Jupiter-sized bodies are classed as brown dwarf stars. And since the glowing plasma sheath is far larger than the body within, the standard mass luminosity calculations are misleading. Their light has nothing to do with the imagined surface of a cooling, failed star, which may be one reason why brown dwarf masses are notoriously difficult to measure. In December 2008, NASA published a report, Astronomers Find the Two Dimmest Stellar Bulbs, in which the luminosity of a brown dwarf was theoretically too high for its measured temperature. The report reads, something was puzzling. The brightness of the object was twice what would be expected for a brown dwarf with its particular temperature. The solution? The object must have twice the surface area. In other words, it's twins, with each body shining only half as bright, and each with a mass of 30 to 40 times that of Jupiter. Both bodies are 1 million times fainter than the Sun in total light, and at least 1 billion times fainter in visible light alone. In December 1999, I wrote in Other Stars, Other Worlds, Other Life? The apparent size and color of an electric star is an electrical phenomenon. If Jupiter's magnetosphere were lit up at opposition, it would appear the size of the full moon. The light of a red star is due to the distended anode glow of an electrically low-stressed star. Red giants are a more visible and scaled-up example of what an L-type brown dwarf star might look like close up.
Circling back now to the impossibly, rapidly accreting so-called rogue planet, I implore everyone, be they supporters of the electric universe theory or not, to consider the discovery in the largest possible context of evidential data. The fact is, it's now clear that it does not take a million years to form a planet or a star, and therefore, the theoretical history of our own solar system, as well as every star and exoplanetary system that astronomers observe, must now be radically reconsidered. In a comparison of the respective theoretical predictions of gravity-centric cosmology and the electric universe, a planet or star accreting at up to 6 billion metric tons per second is an overwhelming slam-dunk victory for the electric universe. Magnetism is the product of electric currents, and it is the electromagnetic scavenging effect of the Z-pinch along Birkeland current filaments that produces both stars and gas giant planets. I think it was important for us to hear Wall discuss these facts in his own voice, providing a visceral link to a teacher whose insights continue to illuminate our journey toward a better understanding of this electric universe.